common method of analysis in molecular biology and biotechnology is gel electrophoresis, sometimes referred to as DNA fingerprinting. In this video, we'll discuss what gel electrophoresis is, how it works, how it's performed, and how its results can be used to solve problems, including a 3,000-year-old mystery from ancient Egypt. Okay, here we go. The name gel electrophoresis gives us a clue about what it does. The name itself means gel electrical carrying. In general, gel electrophoresis is a process by which molecules in a sample are strategically separated and sorted using their size and charge. The separation allows us to infer a lot about a substance. The process can be applied to different types of macromolecules such as proteins and nucleic acids. For the purpose of this tutorial, we'll be using DNA as the molecule. To understand gel electrophoresis better, it's helpful to imagine it as a group of contestants trying to complete a race where they have to go over, under, or around a series of obstacles as fast as they can. Some competitors can run the course solo, but others have been assigned to compete while physically attached to several teammates. When the referee shouts go, the solo competitors can navigate through the course quickly, but the contestants who are part of large groups will have trouble going around or squeezing through certain hurdles, even if they're able to rearrange themselves into a slightly speedier and more streamlined configuration. Without even seeing the different teams perform, it would be easy to infer the size of a group based solely on how far they progressed through the obstacles in a given amount of time. The solo competitors would get the farthest, the small teams in the middle, and the biggest teams would progress the least far. Molecules work in much the same way as they progress through a gel. There are several basic steps to performing gel electrophoresis: pouring the gel, preparing the samples, loading the gel, running the gel, and staining the gel. We'll go through each of these steps in turn. Pouring the gel is the process of creating the molecular obstacle course that the fragments will move through. The two most commonly used gels are composed of either agarose or acrylamide. Usually, 0.5% to 1% agarose is used, or 0.5 to 1 gram per 100 milliliters. Any more than that and the gel may be too dense for molecules to pass through. The agarose is melted, then poured into a mold in the correct shape. Before it cools, a special comb is placed at one end, creating a line of divots, or wells, to hold each of the samples. Preparing the samples involves adding dye. DNA is clear, and so is the gel, and the dye helps you to see how quickly your samples are progressing in real time. The dye is also heavy, and it helps the samples to settle into the bottom of the wells, rather than taking a shortcut and floating out over the top. The most common type of loading dye is called bromophenol blue. Before loading the gel, you first remove the comb, place the solidified gel into a gel box tank with the wells at the negative end, and then cover it with a liquid called a buffer. The buffer will help to conduct the electrical current, and it will also ensure that the pH is optimal for the reaction to occur. Then, to load the samples into the gel, use a sophisticated dropper tool called a micropipette to carefully squirt one sample into each of the wells. The word carefully is important because it's pretty easy to accidentally poke a hole in the gel with the tip of the micropipette, and then the sample will leak out. It's also easy to get the samples mixed up, so it's important to write down which substance went into which well. To run the gel, we expose it to an electrical field. The amount of voltage varies, usually from 20 to 100 volts, depending on the size of the fragments you're using. The more voltage you apply, the faster the fragments will move and the sooner you can analyze the results, but the results are often less clearly visible. DNA has a negative charge because it contains phosphate groups, so it will flow away from the negative end and towards the positive end of the field when you turn the box on. The movement across the gel is called migration. Usually, you run the gel until you can see that the dye fragments have progressed about halfway through the gel. Again, finding balance is important. If you run the gel for too short a time, the fragments won't have a chance to separate. Run it too long, however, and the smallest fragments could reach the opposite end of the gel and run right off the end. The final step is staining, where we add additional dye that sticks to the DNA bands so that we can see them. The stain can be added while making the gel, or the gel can be soaked in a solution after it's finished running. Remember that the loading dye just shows you how fast your samples are moving, so you can stop the reaction at the right time. It doesn't actually make the DNA itself visible. Up until recently, ethidium bromide was used, but since it's now known to be a carcinogen, other stains are more common, particularly in high school and undergraduate labs. Once the gel is stained, it's easy to read it under a UV light. The gel has acted like a sieve to strategically slow the movement of the DNA molecules, allowing us to draw conclusions about them. Smaller molecules are less impeded by the gel mesh than larger molecules. As a result, the shorter DNA fragments will move farther than the longer, bulkier ones in a given amount of time. In this manner, DNA fragments in a solution are separated on the basis of size. Just knowing which fragments are biggest and which are smallest isn't very useful on its own. Luckily, by adding some additional reagents, we can learn even more about the DNA we're examining. We're now going to expand on this basic process by learning more about DNA ladders and restriction enzymes. Often, researchers use a substance called a DNA ladder to learn exactly how big a fragment is, in addition to whether it's bigger or smaller than its peers. They add a mixture of DNA fragments of known sizes into one of the wells, run them along with the unknown samples, and then compare them. If an unknown fragment progressed as far as a known 300 base pair fragment, for instance, we can infer that the unknown fragment is about 300 base pairs in length. We can also use logarithms and inverse logarithms to infer fragment size based on the distance traveled, but that's outside the scope of this video. Restriction enzymes tell us if the fragments in two samples are identical. Restriction enzymes are proteins that cut DNA in very specific locations. They scan along the DNA molecule until they find a site or sites with a particular configuration of nucleotides. Then they sever the DNA in that spot. Usually, these sites are palindromic sequences. For instance, a common restriction enzyme called EcoR1, originally isolated from E. coli, scans DNA for the sequence of GAATTC on the 5' strand, or CTTAAG on the 3' strand. It cuts between the G and the A, creating two overhangs called sticky ends. These can be useful for a number of other purposes. These enzymes exist in nature, and we have learned to harness them to compare DNA samples. If we add the same restriction enzyme to identical samples, the enzymes will cut the DNA in exactly the same spots, resulting in identically sized restriction fragment pieces. If the samples are not identical, the enzyme will cut the DNA in different places, resulting in differently sized fragments. There are many restriction enzymes, and each has a preferred target. When comparing samples, it's important to use the same enzyme or combination of enzymes in every single sample. In this example, we can see that using different enzymes created differently sized fragments, even though the two DNA sequences are identical. Because roughly 99% of the genome is identical between humans, you can't just amplify and digest any section of the DNA and expect to get useful information. Instead, researchers have identified a number of locations on the genome that are highly polymorphic, that is, areas that tend to have a lot of variation between humans. When we digest these fragments with restriction enzymes, it can tell us if samples are identical. Even if you choose the correct regions of DNA to test, it's still very important to pay close attention to the reaction conditions. Some enzymes can get a bit overexcited and perform extra cuts even when it doesn't find its exact restriction site. This extra cutting is known as star activity. Low salt concentration, high pH, or just adding too much enzyme are just a few of the conditions that can cause this, so following the protocols closely is very important to get accurate results. Gel electrophoresis has many applications. We might use it to analyze the results of a procedure such as polymerase chain reaction, or PCR, in order to make sure that the correct product has been created. And we might use it to analyze genes associated with a specific condition or illness. We might also use it to compare genetic material from a crime scene to a sample taken from a database. This particular application of gel electrophoresis is why it's sometimes called DNA fingerprinting. Everyone always thinks of CSI and true crime when they think of DNA fingerprinting, but did you ever think it could also be useful in Egyptology? In 1922, a group of archaeologists unearthed the tomb of King Tutankhamun, now possibly the most famous pharaoh of ancient Egypt and known informally as King Tut. It was unclear until very recently exactly how he was related to other members of the royal line, including several other mummies discovered in the Valley of the Kings. From 2007 to 2009, a group of specialists at the University of Cairo analyzed DNA samples taken from 11 royal mummies. They hoped to better understand how they may have been related to one another and to search for possible genetic disorders and markers of infectious diseases. In the case of King Tut, scientists carefully extracted tiny samples of tissue from his femur, isolated the DNA from it, and replicated it using polymerase chain reaction in order to have enough material for analysis. They were then able to compare 8 specific areas of his DNA to those of other mummified people, similar to a modern paternity test. Notice how King Tut's sample shares certain bands in common with his father and/or his mother, but does not share as many with the unrelated sample. The researchers identified the remains of both of King Tut's parents. However, in the process, they discovered that King Tut's parents were brother and sister. This consanguinity was very common at the time, and it may explain why so many of the royal family, including King Tut, who died at age 19, died so young, and also why he was apparently not able to have children. Scientists also used DNA analysis to determine that the 2 fetuses who were mummified and buried along with King Tut were likely his 2 stillborn daughters. However, some researchers debate these findings as they believe the quality of the DNA may have degraded in the thousands of years that have passed and the results may not be entirely accurate. This story is interesting, and if you'd like to learn more, I've left a link to the research papers in the video description, along with links to all the other sources I used to create this video. That wraps up our discussion of gel electrophoresis. If you found this video useful, please show your support by recommending it to a friend and by giving it a like, a comment, or by clicking the subscribe button. Thanks for watching. See you next time.